presents If I Stay by Gayle Forman, read by Kirsten Potter. 7:09 a.m. Everyone thinks it was because of the snow, and in a way, I suppose that's true. I wake up this morning to a thin blanket of white covering our front lawn. It isn't even an inch, but in this part of Oregon, a slight dusting brings everything to a standstill as the one snowplow in the county gets busy clearing the roads. It is wet water that drops from the sky, and drops, and drops, and drops, not the frozen kind. It is enough snow to cancel school. My little brother, Teddy, lets out a war whoop when Mom's AM radio announces the closures. "Snow day!" he bellows. "Dad, let's go make a snowman!" My dad smiles and taps on his pipe. He started smoking one recently as part of this whole 1950s father knows best retro kick he's on. He also wears bow ties. I am never quite clear on whether all this is sartorial or sardonic. Dad's way of announcing that he used to be a punker but is now a middle school English teacher, or if becoming a teacher has actually turned my dad into this genuine throwback. But I like the smell of the pipe tobacco. It is sweet and smoky and reminds me of winters and wood stoves. "You can make a valiant try," Dad tells Teddy, "but it's hardly sticking to the roads. Maybe you should consider a snow amoeba." I can tell Dad is happy. Barely an inch of snow means that all the schools in the county are closed, including my high school and the middle school where Dad works, so it's an unexpected day off for him, too. My mother, who works for a travel agent in town, clicks off the radio and pours herself a second cup of coffee. "Well, if you lot are playing hooky today, no way I'm going to work. It's simply not right." She picks up the telephone to call in. When she's done, she looks at us. "Should I make breakfast?" Dad and I guffaw at the same time. Mom makes cereal and toast. Dad's the cook in the family. Pretending not to hear us, she reaches into the cabinet for a box of Bisquick. "Please, how hard can it be? Who wants pancakes?"
I do,
Teddy yells.
"Can we have chocolate chips in them?"
"I don't see why not," Mom replies.
"Woohoo!"
Teddy yelps, waving his arms in the air. "You have far too much energy for this early in the morning," I tease. I turn to Mom. "Maybe you shouldn't let Teddy drink so much coffee." "I've switched him to decaf," Mom volleys back. "He's just naturally exuberant." "As long as you're not switching me to decaf," I say. "That would be child abuse," Dad says. Mom hands me a steaming mug and the newspaper. "There's a nice picture of your young man in there," she says.
"Really? A picture?"
"Yep. It's about the most we've seen of him since summer," Mom says, giving me a sidelong glance with her eyebrow arched, her version of a soul-searching stare. "I know," I say, and then, without meaning to, I sigh. Adam's band, Shooting Star, is on an upward spiral, which is a great thing, mostly. "Ah, fame, wasted on the youth," Dad says, but he's smiling. I know he's excited for Adam. Proud, even. I leaf through the newspaper to the calendar section. There's a small blurb about Shooting Star with an even smaller picture of the four of them, next to a big article about Bikini and a huge picture of the band's lead singer, punk rock diva Brooke Vega. The bit about them basically says that local band Shooting Star is opening for Bikini on the Portland leg of Bikini's national tour. It doesn't mention the even bigger to me news that last night Shooting Star headlined at a club in Seattle and, according to the text Adam sent me at midnight, sold out the place.
"Are you going tonight?"
Dad asks. "I was planning to. It depends if they shut down the whole state on account of the snow."
"It is approaching a blizzard,"
Dad says, pointing to a single snowflake floating its way to the earth. "I'm also supposed to rehearse with some pianist from the college that Professor Christie dug up." Professor Christie, a retired music teacher at the university who I've been working with for the last few years, is always looking for victims for me to play with.
"Keep you sharp so you can show all those Juilliard snobs how it's really done," she says. I haven't gotten into Juilliard yet, but my audition went really well. The Bach suite and the Shostakovich had both flown out of me like never before, like my fingers were just an extension of the strings and bow. When I'd finished playing, panting, my legs shaking from pressing together so hard, one judge had clapped a little, which I guess doesn't happen very often. As I'd shuffled out, that same judge had told me that it had been a long time since the school had seen an Oregon country girl. Professor Christie had taken that to mean a guaranteed acceptance. I wasn't so sure that was true, and I wasn't 100% sure that I wanted it to be true. Just like with Shooting Star's meteoric rise, my admission to Juilliard, if it happens, will create certain complications, or more accurately, would compound the complications that have already cropped up in the last few months. "I need more coffee. Anyone else?" Mom asks, hovering over me with the ancient percolator. I sniff the coffee, the rich, black, oily French roast we all prefer. The smell alone perks me up. "I'm pondering going back to bed," I say. "My cello's at school, so I can't even practice."
"Not practice? For 24 hours? Be still, my broken heart," Mom says.
Though she has acquired a taste for classical music over the years, it's like learning to appreciate a stinky cheese. She's been a not always delighted captive audience for many of my marathon rehearsals. I hear a crash and a boom coming from upstairs. Teddy is pounding on his drum kit. It used to belong to Dad, back when he'd played drums in a big-in-our-town, unknown-anywhere-else band, back when he'd worked at a record store. Dad grins at Teddy's noise, and seeing that, I feel a familiar pang. I know it's silly, but I have always wondered if Dad is disappointed that I didn't become a rock chick. I'd meant to. Then, in third grade, I'd wandered over to the cello in music class. It looked almost human to me. It looked like if you played it, it would tell you secrets. So I started playing. It's been almost 10 years now, and I haven't stopped.
"So much for going back to sleep,"
Mom yells over Teddy's noise.
"What do you know? The snow's already melting," Dad says, puffing on his pipe.
I go to the back door and peek outside. A patch of sunlight has broken through the clouds, and I can hear the hiss of the ice melting. I close the door and go back to the table.
"I think the county overreacted," I say.
"Maybe, but they can't uncancel school. Horse is already out of the barn, and I already called in for the day off," Mom says.
"Indeed. But we might take advantage of this unexpected boon and go somewhere," Dad says. "Take a drive. Visit Henry and Willow."
Henry and Willow are some of Mom and Dad's old music friends who'd also had a kid and decided to start behaving like grown-ups. They live in a big old farmhouse. Henry does web stuff from the barn they converted into a home office, and Willow works at a nearby hospital. They have a baby girl. That's the real reason Mom and Dad want to go out there. Teddy, having just turned 8 and me being 17, means that we are long past giving off that sour milk smell that makes adults melt.
"We can stop at Book Barn on the way back," Mom says, as if to entice me.
Book Barn is a giant, dusty old used bookstore. In the back, they keep a stash of 25-cent classical records that nobody ever seems to buy except me. I keep a pile of them hidden under my bed. A collection of classical records is not the kind of thing you advertise. I've shown them to Adam, but that was only after we'd already been together for 5 months. I'd expected him to laugh. He's such the cool guy with his peg jeans and black low tops, his effortlessly beat-up punk rock tees and his subtle tattoos. He is so not the kind of guy to end up with someone like me. Which was why when I'd first spotted him watching me at the music studios at school 2 years ago, I'd been convinced he was making fun of me and I'd hidden from him. Anyhow, he hadn't laughed. It turned out he had a dusty collection of punk rock records under his bed.
"We can also stop by Gran and Gramps for an early dinner," Dad says, already reaching for the phone. "We'll have you back in plenty of time to get to Portland," he adds as he dials.
"I'm in," I say.
It isn't the lure of Book Barn, or the fact that Adam is on tour, or that my best friend Kim is busy doing yearbook stuff. It isn't even that my cello is at school or that I could stay home and watch TV or sleep. I'd actually rather go off with my family. This is another thing you don't advertise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.